it's a good one at that. God is good. I woke up at 4:44 this morning, which is, wide awake at 4:44, which is great unless you didn't get to bed till after midnight. So anyway, we'll be okay. We'll pull it out. Amen. It's a great subject this morning. I got inspired last week when Mark Collard was here, when he was talking about the creative power of words, because that actually, that revelation, that message was what I came into the kingdom on. We got born again into what was called then, still is, called the Word of Faith movement. And some of the foundational principles is the power of the Word of God, the power of the spoken Word of God. And we've seen God do so many things as he's inspired us to pray and declare and prophesy things that, you know, starting new businesses, third church plant for us, plus we've been involved from foundation on other church plants and seen things that come out of the ground as zero and go on to great success. And prayer and proclamation, declaration, getting God's vision in your heart and corresponding with actions, it's how the kingdom works. Amen. So this is a foundational message. It's sort of exciting to preach, but it's really hard to implement. And we'll see why. But there's some things that make it super challenging just fundamentally. Why this all works is because in the beginning was the Word, who is Jesus. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Say, the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him, nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. That was the true light, which gives light to every man, woman coming into the world. Let's just pray on that point right now. Wow, Jesus, we honor you this morning. You are the Word. You are the light. You're the life. And you give your life, you give your light to all men, all women coming into the world. That's our basis for conscience. That's why that we have this thing in our heart that wants to know you, God. And we just ask you today that you would manifest yourself in your light, in your life, that you would make the Word alive to us, that we could comprehend, as Paul prayed, with all of the saints, the height, the breadth, the length, and the depth, and to know the love of God. We just pray that for each other, for one another. Lord, I thank you for the anointing to share, to teach. Thank you for inspiration. We just pray that there would be a fruitfulness in this time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So in the beginning, he was the Word, and the creation, the universe came into existence because God said, let there be light. There was light. How many know light was created before the sun, the moon, and the stars on day later? Light came into existence. So light was probably a substance. When God said, let there be light, it was probably a creative substance. It was a creative base that we don't really understand when we think about light being measured light that we actually see and perceive with our own eyes, right? Light's something beyond has far more reaching creativity than just the idea that you and I flip switches and then all of a sudden the room's visible. Amen? So with that light, let there be light. Then from that light, God began to create. And this was a quote last week that Mark had. This is from Derek Prince. Words are the material out of which the whole universe is constructed. It's not too much to say, therefore, that in committing to man the faculty of speech, God committed to man his own divine creative power. That's a powerful phrase, but it's so biblical. And that's the absolute truth. It's just, for you and I, we just don't know how to operate in that, or we get talked out of it, or we just don't become educated in that dimension of being a believer, being connected to God. And so that's what this morning is about, to talk about those things and to encourage us, some with facts, some with science, some with biblical teaching, but I just want to hopefully stimulate us to lay hold of this foundation. There's a recent movie that came out. It's called The Heal, and it's available on Amazon Prime. It's more from the scientific standpoint, but it includes things about the spirit and the soul of a human, and really the interaction between the physical and the spiritual and the soulish. They pulled together experts from the field to talk about this. There's some of you who were in the church, you know, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, don't remember exactly when she came, but Carolyn Leaf came, the South African neuroscientist who very much specializes in the connection between spirit, soul, and the human body. She was amazing. She's got all kinds of great information. But I like this one little film clip because it's just explanatory. And it's got visuals in it that I just want to us to lay hold of. And then we'll go on from here. So the movie is called Heal. And let's go ahead and show the clip.
That our body is a machine. It's, you know, full of organs with buttons and levers that need adjusting. And that you're really not here for any purposeful existence. You know, you're here to live and survive until you die.
Medicine, being derived from Newtonian physics, looks at the body as a physical device, and that if there's anything wrong with it, it is a consequence of a problem in the mechanics of a physical machine. I say, well, this is really cool until 1925. In 1925, a new physics came in, quantum physics. What's the relevant of quantum physics? Well, it said that invisible energy realm that was out there that we did not count and even talk about in medicine because it's just a physical body. It turns out our perception of what is physical is an illusion. There's nothing physical at all. It's all energy.
If you look inside any part of your body with a microscope, so let's say your hand, and you look inside your hand, you find cells. You look inside the cells, you get your DNA in the center of the cell. You look inside the DNA, you find atoms. You look inside the atoms, there's nothing there. Well, there's protons, neutrons, electrons. And what's amazing is inside an atom, there's 99.999999999999% empty space. If a proton was an apple, size of an apple, the closest the electron would be the size of a grain of salt, and it would be approximately 2 kilometers away. Now, that's how much space you would get. Simple pi r squared. The particles themselves, they actually emerge in essentially out of what's called the quantum field. And ultimately, you can think of particles as just waves of energy, just literally vibrations of energy. And I think it shifts your mind from thinking that something is seemingly solid and permanent to perhaps something can change and something can be healed.
Long, long time ago, the word spirit was what? Invisible moving forces that influence the physical realm. Quantum physics is taking us back to a time that said the invisible forces that we have been discounting in medicine turn out to be the primary forces that control everything. And I said, well, what do they include? Mind, consciousness, and this is why, if you want to come back to the supreme power over our biology, it's thought, the invisible energy from our mind that not only shapes our body, but shapes our relationship to the world in which we live.
Amen. So that's not new for some of you. We understand the, you know, in the quantum theory that the idea of the smallest particles are made up of atoms. But when you think about, like what he just gave as an illustration, if I had an apple sitting on my podium right here, and I said, that's the nucleus of the atom, we said, well, the things that make atoms is because there's electrons, there's protons connected inside the nucleus, but there's electrons that spin around the outside of it, sometimes multiple electrons. But you think, okay, if the apple's here, the next closest part of this atom that makes up matter, it would be a grain of salt sitting on a table at In-N-Out Burger. I mean, really, 1.2 miles away, there'd be a grain of salt that would be orbiting around an apple. And when we zoom out on that, if there's enough of them, we call that solid matter. But in fact, there is, it's not really matter. At the smallest inch, well, you'd say, well, the matter is the nucleus and the protons and the neutrons, but that's what makes up matter. But the fact is that the majority of whatever he said, 99.999999, is all space. So what's in the space? Yeah, what's in that? What's in the difference between the nucleus and the electrons? It's spirit. It's that realm where God exists. It's where the scripture says that he upholds all things by the word of his power. It's because God decides to keep electrons connected to the protons. If he decided not to, the whole thing would implode in an instant. But in those gaps, let's say, there's a whole other reality. There's a whole other realm. It's the spirit realm. And in this room right now, we already know, if we believe the word of God in this room right now, there's at least 200 angels. And in addition to that, there would be more angels. And in addition to that, there would be the Holy Spirit. Jesus said that he comes and he's in our midst every time we gather in his name. So somewhere in that space, there's that other dimension, the kingdom dimension. Scripture also makes it clear that there's a kingdom of darkness. And there's spirits who aren't on God's side. And they also cohabitate in that realm. And their spirits are on assignment. And there's things called curses. And there's other dynamics in that whole spirit world that are interacting with you and I. And we're caught in the conflict between those two kingdoms. The forces of good, the forces of light, the forces of darkness, the forces of deception. We're caught in the middle of that. And yet God said, this is how you operate in those things, is through my word. I give you my word and I give you my authority, and you get the revelation, and by releasing my authority, you have influence in the spirit world. Amen? That's the key. That's where the battle is. That's where the battle is won. That's where the battle is to be fought. Jesus made it clear. He said, God is spirit. Those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. But he was joined to the Lord as one spirit with him. That's an interesting thing in the quantum world is now it's not a theory, it's a law of quantum entanglement, is they've proven over and over again, both the mathematicians, but also in the laboratory, that when something is joined or something is paired, that you can then take those atoms and you can separate them anywhere in the universe. Doesn't matter. It can be light years apart. Put influence on this atom, there's an automatic equal response on this atom, even though they're separated by light years of space. Jesus said, your angels are always beholding the face of your Father in heaven. He said, I'll be with you always. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. We are joined. We're connected. He gives his light to everyone that comes into the world. That's where your original connection was with your Creator before the foundation of the world. We're connected. We're integral with him. He wants us to understand and build on those principles because we're getting ripped off. Amen. Then he said, it is the spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. Not our body, the flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life, but some of you don't believe. The interesting thing about the principle that we're talking about, the dynamic between the physical world and the spirit world, it works on it through a medium of faith. It works because people believe. It's so interesting. I'm going to give you some illustrations, some actual research later on that. But the idea that the reason why the spirit world can enter into the physical world and actually make an influence is because there's somebody that believes. There's somebody that takes from the spirit world and manifests it into the physical world. It's the ingredient that causes those things that be not come in as though they were. It's amazing. You and I, that's our role. Hebrews says this, by faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were made of things which were not made of things which are visible. And the word, it's interesting because we look at that and you would first pass. We understand that the world, people would say, no, it's plural. And it is not the actual physical world. This actually, the word is aeon, which means ages. It's also translated a number of times courses, and it also is translated worlds. So by faith, we understand that not just our world, but worlds, but the course of this world, the course of the universe, the course of God's spiritual plan has happened because of what was coming out of the unseen world. And it says he makes it, he frames it. It's to render, to make, to craft, or cause to fit perfectly. And Ramus, utterance, that which is or has been uttered by the living voice. I love this part. Any sound produced by the voice having definite meaning. In other words, he's defining faith. In other words, that when you get something from the unseen world that's of God and it becomes intentional within you and you begin to give voice to it, you begin to give activity to it, you begin to actually manifest it out of the spirit world into the real world. And that's how the kingdom works. Yeah, that's frankly why you're sitting in this room today. Because 20 years ago in a prayer meeting, God said to plant a church. And there, and you start with a few people that are interested, but why does it keep working? Because of prayer, because of declaring, because of faith. It begins to set things in motion. It creates a creativity that people begin to rally around. But that's totally how the universe came into existence. That's how God operates. And he said, I've made you in my image and likeness. So I put creativity in your heart. I put creativity in your mouth. Amen. Practical translation. Things that are invisible, which exist in the spiritual world or the world of the mind and heart, come into natural manifestation through crafting with thoughts and ultimately words declared with faith and intention behind them. That's awesome, but you know what? It can work for good or bad. It's a creative force. What God puts in your heart and comes out of your mouth, it's a creative force. So you can create for both sides. And in one sense, a neutral side. There's the will of man, the will of the devil, the will of God. So man's sort of neutral in where it goes, but the idea that it's a creative power, it's intended to propel the earth and propel the universe and propel us in our dominion that we were given in the garden. Romans 8:10-8. This is how salvation works. What does it say? The rhema, or that uttered word, is near you. It's in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. In other words, Paul said, the word that we preached, it went into your heart. So not only did the word go into your heart, it's near you, it's actually also in your mouth. It's an interesting connection that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God's raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You activate salvation. That's how what Jesus did on the cross is activated in somebody's life. It goes into their heart, what has been preached. They begin to understand, they begin to comprehend, they begin to say, I want that. Then they activate it with their mouth, and he said, you'll be saved. And the word for salvation is not just escaping your butt from hell. It's all of the benefit package. It's deliverance, it's mental health, it's spiritual health, it's peace, it's God's life, it's access to his covenant, it's access to his provision. That's what's in salvation. And he said, with your heart you believe, and with your mouth you confess unto. Amen? Thanks. Luke 17:6. So the Lord said, here we go. If you have faith as a mustard seed, have you ever seen a mustard seed? Yeah, it's smaller actually than a grain of salt. You can say to the mulberry tree, be pulled up by the roots and be planted in the sea, and it would obey you. So either Jesus was lying or he was laying out a principle. Mark 11:23 said something that's actually become more popular is a verse quoted. For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things, what he says, will be done. Christians carry a lot of stuff that they're thinking. They carry a lot of things in their heart. But when does it get to a place when we begin to say? Jesus said, when it is said and you believe it, that's where the manifestation comes. Those things he say will be done. He'll have whatever he says. Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, here's the connector again, believe that you receive them and you'll have them. Is that a true promise? I don't know. I think so. Right? I don't know anywhere where Jesus lied. He'd never been accused of lying. It's never held up in an accusation. And so this actual effect of believing and saying and speaking, not only is it intended for spiritual stuff, spiritual warfare and manifesting the kingdom and shifting the kingdom, but words declared from your heart, again, have an amazing effect on your brain. Last week, Mark said, he used that phrase, you know, now we have scientific evidence. So I texted him and I said, send me those links. Because I know, I trust him when he says he's got scientific evidence, but I like to read it. And then I like to scrutinize it. And then you kind of weigh it on how much faith you want to put, whether you want to preach it or not, right? And so I'm just going to flip through these. But these are websites. Do words have power to change your brain? Psych Central, yes, they do. And it goes on in an article in their researchers. Ideas, this is from the TED group under their science category. People's words and actions can actually shape your brain. A neuroscientist explains how. The power of words, why we need to be intentional with the things that we say. And that's another, that's also in terms of oppression, depression, suicide. These guys are involved in all of that, combating that in society. This is interesting. This is Business Relationship Management Institute. And so the neuroscience behind our words, they know that the profitability of a company is connected to getting everybody in the office to say the same thing. That undercurrents and doubting the vision of a business and doubting the management of a business and doubting the future of a business, when those things begin to be said inside, it undermines the profits. It could take a business, it can take a company out. Because you understand, like, the stock market's highly emotional. So it's what people hear and what people say has an amazing effect. It's the same on your business. So the idea of pulling people together and getting them to say the same thing and getting on the same team and begin to believe and put faith behind the business and behind the product is critical for success. And that's what these guys are about. So they put out a lot of money to research the things that they research. Amen? The nature of the Antichrist. This is a fun segue. Daniel chapter 7, a mouse speaking pompous words, 7:11. I watched then because of the sound of the pompous words which the horn was speaking. 20, a mouth which spoke pompous words. 25, he shall speak pompous words against the Most High. It's an Aramaic word. It says, huge in size and domineering in character. In other words, he's a loudmouth intimidator. He gets loud. He gets contentious. Talks about that he appeared with these sharp teeth in the vision as the Antichrist, as a beast, the ten horn that appeared. So it describes him, but the thing that comes up more and more and more, or the most, about his description, pompous words, a loud mouth, declaring, intimidating. The bummer is, it's both there in the book of Revelations, where it shows up again, the parallel between Daniel and Revelation is amazing. And he was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, was given authority to continue for 42 months. Then he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven. Blasphemy, slander, injurious speaks, accusing, evil speaking. That's the Antichrist. Big mouth, loud mouth, large quantity of words, and very contempting in his language, intimidating, threatening. In both passages in Daniel and in the book of Revelation, he makes war with the saints and has said he's allowed to prevail for a time. So I don't know about you. I'm not sure we're in a 42-month period. I don't think so. But I don't know about you, but the intimidation factor and the right now the battle over cultural and social issues and the heated conversation and just the rhetoric and the tone of the rhetoric and the canceling emphasis behind all of that is just an antichrist spirit. And it gets loud, it gets persecuting, it gets intimidating, and its intent is to make war with the saints, but guess what? If we become intimidated and we back down and we don't declare back to that thing, then it begins to prevail. And we wind up shrinking back into a corner. And you he made alive who are dead in trespasses and sins in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who works in the sons of disobedience. So it's the prince of the power of the air. That this principle that God created the world through faith and words connected to that faith, the Antichrist, the spirit of the age, the spirit of darkness, knows that principle. So intimidate, get you in a corner, and get you and I to talk into that thing, to give faith to it, to give substance to it by agreement and saying the same thing. Oh, the times are dark. Oh, the things are getting worse. I don't know how much more we can take. I don't know how much longer we're going to be able to exist in this darkness. Surely we should pull up and go hide, right? I mean, it's sort of working. There might be a time that might be really wise advice, but it's not right now. Amen? Like, it's time for the church. That's why, let's see. Well, I'm going to give you the good news first. This is what we should be confessing. But the court shall be seated, and they shall take away his, the Antichrist's, dominion, to consume and destroy it forever. Then the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole heaven shall be given to the people, the saints of the Most High. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. Back to that. Yeah, amen. Yeah, that's worth praising about. That similar phrase is repeated at least three times in Daniel's writing and a couple times in the book of Revelation, that this is all allowed to go on. The period of the voice, the pompous words, the blasphemies, it's allowed to go on for a season of time. And in that season of times, he said his intent is to wear out the saints and to change times and to change seasons. And so you go through, and we are going through the aggravation of all of that, but we know this, like, what we just need to do is endure. Endure, do our best to fight, do our best to release the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, do our best to encourage each other and help as many people as possible to move forward in the kingdom. But the day comes and the time comes when it all gets reversed. And the promise of God that the kingdom of our God and his Christ shall reign forever and ever and ever. All things shall be put under Jesus' feet, and those who rule and reign with him will be given the kingdom forever and ever and ever. Amen? So you're to encourage yourself with that thought. Okay, we're going to get through this. We're going to get through this. And so this is kind of like the macro picture of things. And Mark 16:15, Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. I really, in Dale last night, thought that word meant to every creature. So that means, you know, the birds, the trees, and I've done the praise and just begin to declare Jesus Christ is Lord, Jesus Christ is King, like a fool for hundreds of times, driving in my car by myself. Then I looked at the word. It's actually that word creature. It actually means creation. It actually refers to a structure. So when Jesus said, here's the authority, I want you to go preach the gospel to everything that's been built, every structure of mankind. Every organization, every brainchild of a human, because sometimes that's connected to the wrong brain. Every institution, everything that persecutes, everything that denies Christ, everything that lies about the truth. Go after that and preach the gospel to that creature, because he goes on and he says, for the ones who will be saved, the ones who will believe will be saved. So he's talking, the next sentence he says it's actually people. So he's talking about human structures. Things that have been built, things that have been created. Go take the gospel into that thing and preach the gospel to it, because inside of that, there's going to be some people that are going to hear. And anybody that hears, he says, and anybody believes, he shall be saved. But if they're not and don't, they won't be. It's just the reality of it. I hate that part. Then it goes on. The tongue has the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat its fruit. The tongue has the power of life and death. That's amazing. This is why it's hard. James says, for we all stumble in many things. If anyone does not stumble in word, he's a perfect man, able also to bridle the whole body. Connection between the tongue and the whole body, our whole body. James 3:6, and the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature, and it's set on fire by hell. Ouch. How many times does that happen in our home? Amen? Things escalate. There begins to be like a little aggravation. All of a sudden, a little frustrated. All of a sudden, we're saying things, right? All of a sudden, we're saying destructive things, things that harm our spouse, things that create tension, things that the demons love, occupying that airspace between here and In-N-Out Burger. They're in that space. And if you don't think they come into your house, you got to be kidding. If you don't think that they're attracted to an argument, you got to be kidding. And so when things begin to escalate, because the tongue's vulnerability is to go into a rant. The tongue's vulnerability is to go into criticism. The tongue's vulnerability is to strengthen the purposes of hell. And that's what James said. It's a world of iniquity. It sets a course for things. It can ruin, you get in a fight, it can ruin the next 24 hours of harmony in your home, right? That can last more than 24 hours. You'd say, God, I wish it was just 24 hours. But you can set off something, because what happens is you've created a course and it's set on fire of hell. It's intended for divorce. It's intended to divide. It's intended to create breakups. It's set on fire by hell. It's a course. It's the same thing that we read. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed. The worlds, the course was framed. The declared word connected to beliefs sets a course, sets a direction. Hell's trying to get a hold of your tongue. to activate things that demons can activate about. Oh, me. Oh, me. So, if we would have gone further in the healing video, I want to shift for a sec. There were some amazing people in that video, and one of them is this lady right here, Kelly Turner. For 10 years of research that she's done, and called, I didn't even know this was a field of study, radical remissions. So radical remissions are when somebody has been given a diagnosis, usually terminal, that they begin to do something that causes a radical remission. The disease backs up and oftentimes leaves and they're declared healed. They're declared without disease. Miracles can do that. Healing miracles, healing anointing, those things can do that. But in addition to that, so she's evaluated over 1,500 cases worldwide and 250 in-depth interviews with people who, quote, cured themselves with these principles. And there'd be no mystery here. They're spiritual principles. The radically changing your diet and using herbs and supplements, they're darkened because those are the biological responses. And everybody would know that. It's kind of in that clip when it started off, our body's a machine. It needs proper nutrition. Medicine can help affect systems within our body. That natural world, yeah, that's part of it. That's why they're listed on this page. But the thing that a lot of people don't connect to is the idea of somebody saying, I need to take control of my health. I need to learn. I need to understand. I need to know what's going on inside of me. Then following your intuition, for us, it would be prayerfully being led by the Spirit concerning our health. But these things are really important. Releasing suppressed emotions. Increasing positive emotions. Embracing social support. Deepening your spiritual connection. And this is really important. Have a strong reason for living. You have to have a reason to pull yourself up by the bootstraps. Amen. And for a believer, it's because we want to do the will of God. Yeah, I've said dozens and dozens of times, like one of the things since the mid-80s, I started studying before it was even called the near-death experiences. Now that's an area of study. But before it was that, just the testimonies mainly of Christians, some non-Christians, who died and then came back. And it's amazing, of course, because they came back, they would have got this from Jesus or from who they encountered. Sometimes they weren't sure. It just came out of light and peace. But the term, you have to go back because you're not done yet. Your mission's not over yet. Almost everybody that came back is told it's not your time. There's still more for you to do. But most believers, including people that had that experience, they said, I don't know what that is yet. So it takes a while to figure it out. I was in... it's been a while since I told this, but I was at Shumash, outside at Shumash. Another friend that I won't mention his name was inside. The truth is we had just done a Bible study, and we were coming back, and is Ed. And so he this guy ministers all over the place. So there was a dealer in Shumash that he wanted to see and just encourage. So I followed him in, and then it was too smoky. So I went outside, and there was a bunch of people out there, and I started a conversation with a guy named Mark Snow. And there was a group of people. I said, what's going on with the America concert? That band America had been there. It just let out, and people are, you know, taking off because I'm waiting for my shuttle bus. So no, and then he just said this. He goes, I think I was the only guy in there that was had a seat next to me that was empty. I said, oh, wow, well, it's kind of an interesting thing to tell me. So I said, why do you think that is? Oh, I'm just going through some social things. I'm a little awkward socially. Oh, really? Yeah, he said, I had an accident. It was a few months. I don't remember the time. I had an accident, and I hit my head, and it's kind of been a slow recovery process. I said, wow, you had brain damage then. He goes, yeah, actually, I was dead. I said, wow, well, you're back. And he goes, yeah, I'm back. And I said, did you see anything when you were over there? And the conversation changes at that point. He goes, yeah. He pointed to a sconce on the wall. He said, it looked like that light, except it was bluer. I said, yeah, did you hear anything? He said, yeah, I heard that all my BS has been forgiven. That's what he used the full word. I said, wow, well, that's good news. And he said, Anything else? And he said, yeah, that I had to go back because there's a plan for my life, but I don't know what the F it is. And I said, maybe that's why we're talking, Mark. And he said, well, what do you do? And I wish you would have said something different. But as soon as I told him I was a pastor, he shut down. And so he talked a little bit with me. I got his phone number, but he's never picked up since. But then his shadow showed up, and he was going on. Then he said, hey, can I ask you one thing? I said, yeah, sure. He goes, how do the Mormons find you? I said, what do you mean? He said, I live in a trailer way out in the country under these trees, and yesterday these Mormons came knocking at my door. I said, Mark, before you spend any time talking to those guys, make sure you and I talk first. Okay. He gave me a thumbs up. But it's just that idea. There's a plan for my life. I got sent back for it, but I don't know what it is. And over that you hear that. And so for most of us who that's kind of a distant thing, like what is the will of God? The key for health and the key for these principles working is that you have a strong reason for living. Something to fight for. You got a vision. I want to please Jesus. I want to finish strong. I want to do what he called me to do. And if I don't know what that is, I'm just going to do my best to encourage people. Amen? Okay, we're almost done. But I like this guy a lot, this next guy. Masaru Emoto. So in back, it was 2004, he wrote a book called The Hidden Messages in Water. And many call him a pseudoscientist. He's been criticized, but there's a lot of people that have also followed up on this experiment that he did and has validated his work. So again, it's sort of like when you're talking about this realm of science or this, let's just say the spiritual realm, the skeptics build a case and the believers build a case. And again, the only reason why it works and the reason why, I'll show you in a minute, but the reason why it probably has only been reproducible by people who believe is because we're talking about a really amazing realm of belief. And it's basically this idea that the emotional imprinting of water. And so he took these water crystals, or actually little vials of water, some were bigger, and he submitted them to pictures and words and music. And then after a period of time, he froze them and then looked at the crystals under a microscope. And so the word thank you, look at the word thank you versus down to you make me sick. Look at the word wisdom, truth, eternal, angel, I love you, peace, then you fool. And that you make me sick and then evil. So the influence in front of the where the water was stored, he had little signs and then he had music and then they would also make declarations over these things of water. Repeatedly, I don't remember over the length of time, but then they froze it and they looked at the crystals on the inside and that's what they saw. They had one for Hitler. It was gross. They had one for Beethoven's music versus heavy metal. Guess what? Beethoven looked a lot better. But the idea that water carries memories, that you can transmit emotion into that. Think about your body being 70% water. Think about the idea that continual flow of words against you or people saying things about you or even growing up. Curses, you'll only be this, you'll never be that. That just programming is going into memory somewhere and is into my neural, but they also know that the memory, there's more neural memory cells in your intestinal lining than in your brain. So there's things that get imprinted, there's things that get carried on the inside that have an effect on us. This guy's one of the defenders that came up, this was 2018. And that graphic up in the picture, he was doing it instead of frozen crystals, he was doing it with droplets of water that just dried. And then they looked in the microscope. And the experimenter, there was something came that was an emotional shock. So out of the same syringe where the drops came, the experiment was continued out of the same syringe after this bad news had come. And he dried it and just out of curiosity looked at it. And the one with shock was is the picture on the right, the one before where everything was emotionally normal was on the left. Think, could we be that sensitive? Yeah, we are. things affect us. There's things that come into your spirit. And because it's what we're intended to do is to communicate with God out of our spirit, that's what purity is important. Amen? So this, I did my own experiment. So the emotional imprinting of golf balls. Now, the one on the left is a brand new Titleist. The one on the right is one that I played with. That's not from scuffing with the club. That's from cursing. Where's the title right off of it? Over and over, you... Mike Zimmerman could tell you that's true. But we get golf together, but we've made a pact that what's said on the golf course stays on the golf course. Amen. Okay, so what's the takeaway for today? Equipping people for life through faith in Jesus Christ. So this is intended to be an equipping message. It's intended that we would understand the fact that we're spiritual beings created in the image and likeness of Jesus, right? Never forget that. Your words are powerful and creative and ultimately frame the world you live in, whether you want it to or not, right? Whether we want it to, it's a foundational principle of the universe. Words impact what ultimately manifests. And so we ultimately live in the world that we've discussed. Miracles can be instant and dramatic via the power and sovereign intervention of God, which we believe in. Supernaturally, God will touch somebody. In the revivals that I studied, particularly in Azusa, there's an amazing amount of miracles where arms grew back and fingers grew back, and multiple times they saw limbs grow back on people's bodies. And other times it's just disease, chronic disease that people have had for years lifts. We've been part of that ourselves. Cancers removed from people's bodies. So things can happen via the power of God and sovereign intervention of God. But miracles also can be progressive and subtle via the power of God working through your spirit and the processes built into creation. Just don't stay stuck. Amen? I mean, if anything else, I'd say that's like the motivation is that there's been times in my life that I've felt stuck. And no doors are opening. I feel like the circumstances have been overwhelming. And at one point in time when I was bivocational working and pastoring, the pressure got so intense, the stress got so intense, it manifested in my physical body. I spent thousands of dollars trying to figure out what it was. And in the end, it was stress. In the end, it was because I lost connection to my spiritual peace. And for a lot of us, those are things that are going on in us. And a lot of us, the miracle that we need is actually begin to change your inward dialogue. Begin to change and just purify your spirit with faith. Purify your spirit with truth. Confession, meditation. I know in that period, I'd get on the treadmill and I had back then it was a CD. I'd put the CD in, it was healing scriptures and healing songs. And I had to learn for it to become therapeutic, because the first time when I'd step on, it would be a 45-minute session, and I'd begin to walk and hear this guy's voice. It was creepy. And the first thing, it reminded me of the fact that I had a problem I needed to be healed from. And I had way too much adrenaline and way too much drive to want to take time to heal. But if I didn't stop, what it did was getting worse. So I needed to heal. So I'd hear this guy, I got to slow down for Poindexter. You got to listen to his voice. It was so monotone. But then I would get past his voice, and then all of a sudden the scriptures that he began to quote started to be washing to me. The washing of the water of the word. The scriptures began to be refreshing. My mind started connecting to the imagery in the scriptures that he was declaring. Started feeling an effect. My blood pressure started going down. Migraines started spacing out and were getting less and less. And ultimately, I came out of that challenge. But I was stuck in the middle. I couldn't figure it out, but I knew I needed a miracle. So I went to prayer meetings. God could have healed me like that. But he wanted me to go through a process. And it's the last thing, because we say to God, please change our chaos. And God says to us, please change your chaos. Right? Oh, God, I need a miracle. Change my chaos. I've given you the principles and the power on how to change it yourself. Would you please change it? Amen. I want you to grow up inside. I want you to understand these principles, because you're called to rule and reign with me forever as sons and daughters in the kingdom. Amen. Amen. God said, let there be light, and there was light. Words have power. Amen. Lord, we just thank you for truth. Thank you for principles. I just want to say one other thing. Like when in the Word of Faith message, when this revelation emerged, and there was a lot of teachers teaching about the power of faith and the power of words, that what happened in Christian circles that we were together, you became, you know, somebody became kind of like the word police. Oh, that's a bad confession. Don't say that. Oh, you just said, don't say that. I don't want anything like that happening as a result of what we talked about. Amen. Let your faith develop between you and God. I believe because of the principle to be more careful, especially reminded again, the careful, that I don't want to release things or launch things in my life or your life or my family or anything. So there will be probably, for me, more of a caution, except on the golf course. Because the golf balls, you know, dime a dozen. Not really. Pro-V, those are $5 balls. Anyway, what is important is that we are encouraging each other. But, you know, those little diagrams of the little crystals? I don't know what would be worse in terms of if you have somebody who becomes critical of somebody because they don't live to a high enough spiritual walk. I think we would defeat the purpose if we became watchers of each other and paying close attention to your confession versus we're going to live it out as a spiritual truth, blessing each other, amen, but it's not going to be part of a scrutiny or a ranking system or evaluate. Don't do that, amen. I'm not going to do it. We're just going to relax, walking things of the kingdom out together, amen. Father, we just thank you right now. We praise you and bless you for the body of Christ. Thank you for my family in this room. Thank you for fruit that remains in Jesus' name. Thank you for authority in the Spirit. I pray over every person, every marriage, every relationship, every household, especially for those who are stuck in life. Health issues, pain issues, financial issues. We just declare in the name of Jesus, breakthrough. Breakthrough. Father, we activate, if any man or woman be in Christ, they're a new creation. Old things pass away, and behold, all things become new. We declare the new things that are released into the lives of your people in Jesus' name. Old things, old problems, chronic issues, old complaints. God, let them go away. We call them to fall off of us in Jesus' name. And Lord, every demonic assignment, every curse that's been released by witchcraft. You don't know this, but there's people, not they don't even have to be formal witches or whatever, but they are groomed by Satan to say things against believers particularly. And so right now, Father, as the authority that's in Christ, according to the principles of these scriptures, we declare life over the household of God, and we bind every curse that's been declared against us in Jesus' name. Every word comes to no effect. You said that the shield of faith would be able to quench every fiery dart. Right now, we yield the shield of faith. We thank you. Every fiery dart of Satan is pulled out of people's backs, and it's dropped to the ground, and it'll have no effect in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. When you're driving, when you're praying, when you're by yourself, when you're worshiping, the Spirit of God will quicken things to you. But God, we just thank you for every word that was declared that's contrary to us as we were growing up. Every time that somebody put a stigma over us. Every time that there was some limitation that was declared over us and we might have believed and actually living out, walking out. Lord, we reverse that right now in Jesus' name. We thank you for the blessing of God over the people of God, that we are strong, we are healthy, we have the mind of Christ. We thank you for that. You renew our youth, God. I thank you for the other seniors in the room. Thank you for renewing our youth in Jesus' name. We bless our joints in Jesus' name. We thank you for it. Strong back, strong knees, God. Thank you for it. Arthritis wither in Jesus' name. Thank you for health. Thank you for strength. Thank you for sharpness of mind. In Jesus' name, we give you praise. We thank you for this. You're a faithful, faithful healer. Amen. Amen. Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks so much for tuning in. We hope that that message was inspiring, encouraging, and hopefully equipped you for life. And if you're looking to get connected with Equippers Church, you can go to equipperscc.com/connect, fill out a simple form, and someone from our team will be reaching out. You can find all kinds of opportunities to connect, to give, and receive prayer on our website, equipperscc.com. And hey, we really hope to meet you in person sometime, see you in the room. But until then, keep tuning in. We hope that you are blessed by Equippers Church here on YouTube. Love you so much. God bless.